and thank you for joining. I'm Julianne Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. Empowering staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise is one of the many things I'm extremely passionate about. That is why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss the issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I have the pleasure of Andre Young joining me. Andre is a professional speaker, author, leadership trainer, and founder of You Involving Now, LLC. He worked as a mental health therapist for 19 years, played sports at every level from high school to professional, has been an employee, a business owner, self-employed, and has written 4 books focused on enhancing leadership and work-life harmony. As founder of You Involving Now, it's his mission to enhance leadership and work-life harmony for organizations, leaders, employees, and teams with his high-energy, interactive, culture-changing leadership training programs and speaking engagements, allowing a professional and personal evolution. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Andre Young. Welcome, Andre.
Julianne, thank you so much for having me. And you guys listening, thank you for letting me steal a little bit of your time here today.
It's great to have you, Andre. I love speaking with you and also listening to your presentations. I want to start with, I'm not sure if when you were in Milwaukee for our conference, if you saw some of our why videos that we did, some of us personally, about why we got into the industry we are, into the business that we got into. And so I guess I want to dive into that right away, is understanding your why story. What prompted you to start your company, You Involving Now?
It's a great question, because it's never the answer that people think. I didn't want to do this.
Really?
I didn't want to speak. I didn't want to write. And now I can't shut up or stop writing books. So long story short, the business that it is today is not how it started. I went through a divorce about 17 years ago. And through that, it really was one of the worst and best things that ever happened to me. I mean, one, if you've ever been there, you know, it's an emotional time. It's a breaking time, financial. It's just so much. And although I didn't do everything right back then, I did enough that I still felt like I was a good person. And I found that men or women, they typically got in that situation because they had no one good to do good with and nowhere good to go. So all I wanted to do, guys, was to create an organization where men could come and come home better than what they left. And then it kept growing from my living room with friends, and then strangers were sitting on your couch, and that felt weird. So we grew out of the house, and then the coffee shops, and then the conferences, and then a women's division, a youth division. We were on college campuses. And it was all about personal growth, relationship growth, work-life harmony. But the business was going to die doing it that way, because you're always targeting anybody you see out on the street.
Okay.
So I said my business has to go where people already are. They're at work, they're at school, and they're on their phones. So I started going to companies and say, hey, I want to do this for your employees. And this is pre-COVID, before work-life harmony was really big. Mm-hmm. So they said, well, this is great, but how does this help us? And I said, oh my goodness, Julianne, they wanted leadership. And I said, I don't talk about it. And I went home that night and I looked at everything that I had written, videos that I had put out, and I was already talking about leadership. I never said the word.
Interesting.
I added the word to my content that day, and boom, it just took off. And over the years, it's evolved, you know, with more how-tos, more common sense things to do with leading a team, leading your life, leading an organization, and work-life harmony to what it is today. And, you know, I'm so glad that it did, because I can't believe that I get to do this every day.
Wow. That's a great story. Any life lessons to take away from that before we get into like work-life harmony? I want to get into that, but life lessons.
Here's the biggest lesson. Marry your dream, but not the path. So many times we have a dream of what you want your life to look like professionally, at your job, in your field of study, in your relationships.
Mm-hmm.
So we're married to the dream, the vision, but we're also too married to the path. We have to get there the way that we wanted to get there. And life is in the wiggles and squiggles and the detours. So can you find meaning in some suffering? Can you find meaning in a different path? And can you marry? This is huge. Leadership is about creating a marriage. Can you marry what you want to do and give with what the person receiving your effort needs most right now? Mm. I wanted to give my content in a certain way. I wanted to do and be in a certain way, but it's not how the businesses wanted it. So could I marry the dream, but not the path, and marry what I wanted to give with what they needed, and then I won? You're in a relationship. Can you marry what you want to do and give with what your husband or wife needs most right now? And then that's how you win. Can you do that with your employees, your kids? And life tends to start getting really great when you do that consistently.
Interesting. Great, great advice. Thank you. Wow. Well, we're going to dig into your first book, which I'm in the process of halfway through it right now. One of my good books I'm enjoying very much, Seven Ways to Lead. I love that book on leadership. You've already said the term work-life harmony many times. I really want to kind of understand that. I think the audience wants to understand work-life harmony versus work-life balance, because everybody talks about work-life balance. Yeah. Why is it important to understand the difference? Because you really specifically talk about work-life harmony, and I love why you say that.
Well, because work-life balance is a lie. And it's too daggone hard, and it's not as necessary as people think. So, let's talk why it's a lie. Work-life balance, to me, means that everything in your life, from work to life, the kids, the family, your duties, they're all perfectly balanced. As if that's ever the case, and as if that's everybody in your life, professionally or personally, needs the same amount from you. That's not the case. I have four kids and two successful businesses. I have no work-life balance.
No. Mm-mm.
My 23-year-old needs me at a different level than my 3-year-old. Yes, I did say that, from 23 to 3 years right. old. My 15-year-old needs me different than my wife needs me. My one business needs me differently from my other business. So back to that marriage. Work-life harmony is a lie. It's not as necessary, and it's about creating that marriage. Know what the people in your life, professionally or personally, need most from you right now, and marry it with what you want to give, just a little bit outside your comfort zone. And now you can start having work-life harmony. What do you need to nurse yourself through times of change, stress, and celebration, celebrating your successes? What do you need? You matter. What does your significant other need? What does your employees need? What does your boss need? Even if you are the top boss, the CEO, bosses have bosses, and that's called a board. So mm-hmm. What do they need? And then when you start really looking at that, you can get great work-life harmony and not this perfect balance. And even if you could get perfect balance, you know how impossible it is to maintain it?
No way.
Mm-mm. So work-life harmony lets it be fluid. It creates mm-hmm. a great marriage, and it makes you feel and the people around you feel full.
Right, right. I would think that work-life harmony, what you're asking for, what you're really talking about, is you have to talk a lot more. You have to ask questions. What do you need from me? What do you need from me, honey? What do you need from me as an employer? I think that's what you're saying.
Absolutely. You have to be intentionally curious, and especially in a professional setting with more hybrid and remote work.
Mm-hmm.
Hybrid and remote work can build revenue, but not always culture. So the more curious you can be about your people, your boss, your kids, your family, your significant other, the better. Now, if you're leader enough to ask, we have to be leader enough to listen.
Right.
Don't ask a question. You get the answer, and when you dukes up, defend, hey, I already do that. What do you mean? Right. Or you deflect and then blackball that person.
Mm-hmm.
You're leader enough to ask what they need most from you. We're leader enough to be quiet and consume the information. And to be very honest, Julianne and those listening, whatever they say, you don't have to do anything about. But you can't complain about what you don't get.
Right.
And whatever they say, the goal is to do it just a little bit outside of your comfort zone. But you don't want to do it so much that you wind up resenting them or the task or their ask.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So that's the real goal there. And we often have to give them permission to answer us. Because you ask most people, you go up to your boss today and say, hey, I want to be great here. I want to be so daggone great. There's a statue built out of me in front of this building when I walk in the morning. I'm so daggone good. Most leaders will still respond lazily. And you say, I want to be great. What do you need? Ah, just keep doing what you're doing.
Right.
We have to first understand how to judo that, okay? Hey, I appreciate you saying that. I really want to know. So I know you're busy now. Is there a time that we could speak next week? Because I want to ask again. If the answer is the same, then great. If not, I really want to know. Sometimes we have to give our people in our lives permission to answer us truthfully.
Right.
They may not think that you can handle their truth. Maybe they don't think quick on their feet. Maybe they have to pee and they were on their way to the bathroom. Maybe they're hangry and now's not the time. Maybe they just got in an argument with their wife or husband and come into the office and you look just like them and now they're triggered. Who knows?
Right.
Give them permission.
Well, even employees, I think some employees don't want to tell you what they need because they're afraid to really answer you and give you the truth.
Yeah.
Or repercussions of what really, you know. And so how do you break those barriers down of getting them to understand that you really do care? You really do want to know.
My biggest answer is, to be honest, is the one-on-one meetings.
Right.
It is the most powerful thing that you can do to build culture and a culture of trust and curiosity and also evolving your team and company overall.
Mm-hmm.
It's the number one canceled and rescheduled meeting across all organizations. So, you know, I teach, you know, in trainings and from stage, look, when you come in, have your meetings with your people, schedule them 3 months in advance. So you're going to do them once a month, have three scheduled. You don't move them unless the building is falling, the sky's on fire, and you can put it to 20 minutes. Hey, 20 minutes. Most people, if you don't have 20 minutes, there's bigger issues.
Right, right.
And I start with the POW, the POW. Like, what's been your positive of the week? I go first, you share yours. You want to get human to human? Not about me knowing your name, Julianne. It's about me knowing your positive of the week.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, I didn't know your son did this, your daughter did this, or you just did this, or you're going to Italy. That's really cool. That really bonds people.
Right, right.
And then, hey, what do you want to get out of our meeting here today? Then you want to mesh goals. The meeting is not an accident. You called it as the leader. So what do you want to get out of this person, this individual, this experience? Okay, now we have a plan. So moving forward over the next month, this is what we're doing, right? This is what you're doing. We're good. And then in the cherry on top, what was your biggest takeaway from our meeting today?
Oh, I love that. Okay.
Let them answer. Whatever they say is more real and powerful and more important to them than whatever you have to say what was important.
Right.
And they get to walk out of that meeting feeling like they got something.
Right.
In 20 minutes, I've done this meeting in 7 minutes. I've done it in 20. I've done it in 45. There is power in that meeting. And it's not the first meeting. It's not the second. It's the third, fourth, and fifth when you don't cancel and they can expect it. And they start coming in saying, hey, I was thinking about my positive because I knew you were going to ask.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the biggest thing that I've seen that builds culture, that builds trust, that keeps curiosity going. And it starts giving them incentive and skin in the game.
Wow. Wow. I love that. Love that. Okay. One of your other takeaways I had in your book, and this really struck with me because I think it's something I struggle with or feel like you have this saying, heads up, eyes up, smile, move yes. with purpose. So yes. I'm all about that. Even when you make a mistake, make it moving full speed with purpose learn, adjust, evolve on the way. So there were two comments or two things that really struck a nerve with me on that, because it's me. I'm a believer about how you carry yourself. It's a statement. I mean, I'm a fast walker. I watch people constantly. You walk in the building and I see you and you've got your shoulders shrugged, head down. And I'm like, what is it? Just, it says so much. So how do you get people to understand that people like us who are high energy, heads up, we're not fake. This is who we are. Now we do have, I mean, I don't know if you have a bad day. I do have days where I'm like, okay, there's a season over me and I got to figure out how to get my mood right in the right place.
Right.
You know, I don't think you ever have one of those, but I do now and then.
No, you know what? Be honest. I have some of those days. I do. However, I know how I carry myself matters. Mm-hmm. Most of all to myself. So the first thing we have to do is we have to model it. We can't ask for something that we're not modeling. Okay. So I was telling you before we started recording this that one day I had a boss yell at me because I come in every day, hey, happy Thursday, happy Friday, whatever day it was. And he yelled at me and said, you're too daggone happy. And I was so stunned. I was taken back. And we later had a sit down conversation about that because that was crossing my line.
Right.
So there's two sides to it. One, we have to model it. So are we coming in every day and we can never minimize the power of our attention, our head up, making literal eye contact with people, our smile. Do you know there's people coming into work that you don't know what they're going through? They may not have got a smile from their significant other in months. Their kids are too narcissistic by nature. I have four kids. They're all too narcissistic by nature at a certain age to give you what you want and need, you know? So as a boss, you may be the only person in the world giving that gift of a smile,
mm-hmm.
a greeting, and coming in and doing your best and being your best. That I worked at an organization, and I was there for a year. I saw the CEO every day. I could not pick her out of a police lineup. If she committed a crime, she's getting off scot-free. Because I'm 6 foot, she was about 5 foot. And every time she walked by me, her head was in her phone, and I never saw her face, ever.
That's terrible.
I was recruited to play college ball. The football coach that sat in my parents' living room to recruit me never said hi to me for 5 years while I was at that university. We were walking down the hallway, Julian. I saw him see me, and he walked right by. So from that, do you think I was playing for him or for me?
I'm playing for you.
I'm playing for me.
Right.
So that, it all has an effect. And then people will start to model it. Now, there's another side. Some people, I am a motivator type. There's five types of leaders. You and I are a motivator type. The pro is people can see our passion.
Mm-hmm.
The concern is some people hate your guts. They don't like it. They don't like they don't have that same energy, or they feel they need to be that way to manufacture it when they walk into the building, and that's not who they are. Or they think you're fake. You're only doing that because of this, this, or this. A lot of reasons why people don't like or our style doesn't mesh.
Right.
When that's the case, us as the motivators, we have to be able to speak different languages. So I talk about the seven professional languages. You can still be the motivator, but is this person highly motivated by goody time? So that Pete today,
mm-hmm.
whether it's incentives, is it recognition and affirmation? Is it knowledge and or advancement opportunities? Is it respectful emails? So we can still be the motivator, but can we lead with their language?
Okay.
And every single person, if you're not that way, you're not the motivator type, I don't think anybody's asking, nor should that. Can they really ask you to be somebody you're not? Rah, rah, and right. Go doing cartwheels through the office like we do.
Mm-hmm.
What we can expect, and I say as leaders, my expectations, I don't hire, I don't outsource with anybody that are not the three P's. You got to be positive. And positive at least means acknowledge somebody's existence. And positive means that we positively gossip about our duties, our day, our work. Positive means that you look like you want to be here and you're not dragging yourself around here TGIFing Monday through Thursday. Can you be productive? You can be a great leader and a great employee, but without results, it really doesn't matter. Okay? And then you got to be passionate. Be passionate about what you do. You can be all three of those. It's hard for anybody to say much, about you. You know, now you're not doing cartwheels down the office like I am.
Right.
But you're doing way better than you were.
Interesting. So then how about the other half of that sentence of yours or that statement? Make it moving full speed.
Yes.
Purpose, learn, adjust. People, oh boy. You know, it says, even if you make a mistake, keep on going. And I say that to people. I go, I'm a fast mover. I'll make decisions, quick decisions. I'll learn from those decisions and move on.
Yes.
And people get like, don't embrace that as much.
Yes.
They have a hard time with that. And so even some of my managers have a hard time with that with me.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that's something I just have to get along with or just accept, or if there's a style that we have to adjust to get them to understand that are movers and we are set for a purpose and we're going to learn, adjust, and evolve.
Well, here's the beginning of that is, you know, being a football fan, I love Troy Polamalu. So I'm a Steelers fan. Now, if you don't know who Troy Polamalu was, he was a safety for the Pittsburgh Steelers, Hall of Famer. And when he came up to make a tackle, he was clocked going so fast. He came so hard to make this hit. Even when he missed, the whole stadium went, ooh. Even in a miss.
Wow.
So I wanted to design my life around that, that if even when I miss, I am going so hard that people still appreciate that effort. Because they know when you connect, wow.
Right.
So that's been my premise. And some people are not like that. Some people are more hesitant, analysis paralysis, all of these different things.
Right.
So when you have other people in your organization like that, great. Okay. So as a leader, we have to also be able to tolerate mistakes made by our speedy employee. Right. So we have to give them, trust and care that they can go fast and make a mistake and it's okay. Okay. And then what did they learn from it? So there's a series of questions I always like to ask. Okay, hey, look, what are you, this is the task that you have. What are you most anxious about? What are you most excited about? What do you need help with? Okay, great. So now when it's done or while you're doing it, what stood out the most for you? What would you teach somebody else that's coming up behind you? And if you had it to do over again, what would you do differently? Let them digest the experience so they can move faster because they have more confidence. A lot of it is confidence. I also think that we can help them by reverse shadowing. Okay. So typically in the workforce, you're the boss. They're going to shadow you.
Right.
Only goes so far. When I was, in a leadership position, I had people shadow me, but they weren't me. So what I started to do was I shadowed them. So I tell people, I'm not here. You see me, but I'm not here. Just like COVID, living at house, my kids, you see me, but I'm not here today, right? So I want you, everybody, I'm not here. You're going to make the decisions. I'm going to shadow. Now, 2 times a day. So let's say you do this for a week or 2 days or whatever, your length of time, whatever. At lunchtime, I want to say, hey, what were you most proud of that you did this morning, decision-wise? If you had it to do over again, anything, what would you do different? And then we do that at the end of the day. They can get so much more from that than shadowing us sometimes. And it really allows them to be more confident and they can start making decisions faster. The other thing with helping people make decisions faster is give them an authority span. You can make a lot of, I got promoted one time, right? I had no idea what the company wanted from me, and I had no idea how far I can make decisions, if I can make decisions, and what authority I had to make them. So we want people to move fast. Great. This is the expectation. What are you concerned about? What are you excited about? And here's your authority. You can make decisions up to here before checking with me. Lastly, we have to understand that there's something called professional abuse out there. I was doing a training for an organization, my bigger training, and there was a woman that was being reprimanded, I guess, for not making decisions or following through or speaking up more. It was a new company for her. She had just transitioned to another organization. When talking with her, she proceeded to tell me that at her old job, when she made recommendations, she was told to shut the bleep up. Yes, gasp. She was cursed at repeatedly, kicked out of meetings, blackballed. Some people are coming from leadership that you would never have expected that existed in this world. And now they're with you. And now you're telling them, come on, come on, come on, but they're gun shy. So we don't know their story. So when you're having your one-on-one meetings, hey, one of the things I notice is you don't really initiate a lot of things. Can you help me to understand what's going on with that? If somebody in that company would have asked her that as easily as she told me, she would have told them. So those are a couple things that I hope would help a little bit.
That's great. That's great. Thanks. I want to go back to, we were talking about how you start your day and how our attitudes and all that. In your second book, the Leadership, the Leader's Toolbox, which I also have, you talk about the 5 points of your day. Let's dig into those 5 points.
Yes.
Can we talk about each of them?
That is my absolute favorite. I'm so glad you brought that up. I tell anybody listening, you want to live your best life, professionally or personally, do the 5 points of your day. And I'm going to preface it and warn you. It's not doing it simply because you're motivated on Monday and you're going to do it one day a week. It doesn't work like that. You have to do it consistently. I say 5 days a week. You can do the weekends if you like. The first point is what we consume when we wake up in the morning. Most, especially inspired and motivated employees and leaders, the first thing they do, and I hear it all the time, is they wake up, grab their phone, take it to the bathroom, and start checking emails. Want to hate your job in 5 years? Do that every morning and see how you feel about the people in your office, your clients. I love emails. I have to do emails. It's like quicksand, though, even when they're good.
Right.
So, or people grab their phone and they start scrolling TikTok, Instagram, all that. Now, I like reels. I like being entertained like everybody else, where you put on the news. The first 10 minutes of the news, I have you jumping off a bridge.
Right.
Because the world is so horrible, right? And it is, but it's not. So be mindful what you put in your mind and your spirit waking up. So I started, writing. So a lot of my writing happens in the morning. My videos, or I post in the morning. It is impossible for me to have a bad day, have a bad morning. Since 2011, all I've been putting out is positivity at first thing in the morning. It becomes who you are. It becomes what you expect. The other thing is now, second point, organizing your day with who you choose to spend your time around and actually organizing your day. So you get to work, you got a notebook right by your computer. What's your list of things you get to do today? And notice I say get to. 7.5 billion people on the planet, more than half will take everything you complained about right now with a snap of a finger. So what's your list of things that you need to get done today, that you get to do today? And then at the top, it's so vitally important that you put wins. What are your 1, 2, or 3 wins for the day? The list of things to do, especially if you're type A, keeps you busy.
Mm-hmm.
However, it may run the risk of not making you better.
Right.
Your wins, if anything gets crossed off that list for the day, your wins do. Because it makes your days meaningful, your days powerful. That list will never fully get crossed off because I guarantee you'll keep adding to it and then it transfers to the next day.
So that's when you go home and you say, I didn't get anything accomplished today because everybody consumes my time.
Right.
I got everybody else's list done, but not my own.
but not my own. And it's not always about checking everything off. Did your wins get checked off?
Right, right.
And, organizing your day is also who the heck you choose to be around. You know, the water gossip, cooler conversation, negative Nicks and Nancy's, the grouches. We say hi to everybody because we're leaders.
Right.
Okay? But you don't park it and stay and live with everybody. You wouldn't build a home and live with everybody. So please be mindful about that. Point number three, relationship building and self-care. At some point in the day, in the afternoon, we all hit a wall. What do you need to do for you? For me, I love taking a walk. You know, or it might be scrolling something funny on Instagram or whatever. Maybe it's going out to eat lunch with somebody new or someone different or by yourself. Mm-hmm. Reflection time is one of the greatest things for self-love and self-care. We're so busy being entertained by our device that we don't reflect on who we are, what we need, and what other people may need from us. Okay. The other part of that is relationship building. I'm assuming everyone listening has somebody that they love and care about in this world. What would it take to send a 20-second text? We all got the fastest thumbs on the planet. You can send a text in 20 seconds of, hey, sweetie, don't do that to another employee. Don't end up in HR calling somebody sweetie. This is for my wife, hey, beautiful. Yeah, I hope your day is going as amazing as you are. I love you. I can't wait to see you. Sets up the second half of the day nicely. Maybe you got kids. Hey, son, daughter, I was thinking about you. You're awesome. Be great today, and I love you. Hey, mom, dad, thank you for everything. I'm so sorry of how I was as a teenager. So I appreciate it. Something. Do you know what that would, you know how you would feel if you got that from somebody? Give that gift. Point number four is how we return home. We would not, I'm assuming, Julianne, you would not want to hire anybody that would be TGIFing Monday through Friday, looking like they'd rather be anywhere else, complaining and gossiping all the time. However, isn't it so sad that that's how most of us return home from work? That's how most of us shut down the laptop and walk into the living room, complaining about this, complaining about that, dragging themselves around, miserable. You won't believe what I... Same way you want your people walking into work, that's how we come home. Now, what does it take? It may take, maybe I need to go to the bathroom, or let me 15-minute shower to get the day off me. Maybe let me walk the dog. Maybe I need to go to the gym for a half hour, hour to reset, especially with remote work. Our roles are so squished together more than they've ever been. You go from role to role to duty with no de-escalating drive home. Know what you need to break the day. And then lastly, is the best question any single person can ever ask themselves. At the end of the night before you go to bed, from now on, I want you to ask yourself, what was my biggest accomplishment of the day? I swear, having an answer to that question will make you feel like you won the day instead of the day consistently kicking your butt. Mm-hmm. And I hear it from so many people, men too, but mostly women, that they lay in bed at night and all they can think about is all of the things they didn't get done today and then all of the things that they have to do tomorrow.
Right.
No victory in that. Do you know how much you've accomplished by whatever point of the day you're listening to this right now? Do you know how much you've accomplished?
Right, right.
You take it a step further. You got a person sleeping next to you. Ask them. They have an answer that I'm sure you don't know the answer to. Right. Ask your kids. They have an answer I'm sure you don't know the answer to. And now you know what to celebrate with them and appreciate them outside of them simply being your husband or your wife, your boyfriend or your girlfriend, or your kids. They have lives outside of you. Let's celebrate that and appreciate that. Be curious about that.
So true. I started journaling with this 5-minute journal. It's called the 5-minute journal book. And you start 3 minutes in the morning, 2 minutes at night. And it's all about positivity. It's all put in mindset. And I actually gave it to one of my employees who said to me, it has helped him so much refocus his mind from a negative standpoint or feeling being in a depression, kind of almost depression, but focusing more on gratitude.
Yes.
And because it starts in the morning, you start in the morning, what things are you grateful for? Three things you're grateful for, three things you want to achieve today, you know, and at the end, finishing the day with what were your wins for the day? So it really is about mindset.
Oh, everything.
And it's hard sometimes. I'll tell you this quick story. I had a mindset this week. I've been in a season. I said to my husband, boy, we are in a season this year. Really a different season that we're struggling with. And we've had some deaths. We've had some challenges with health, with grandkids and that. And he goes, and I go, boy, it's going to be a tough year of season. He goes, yeah, we're in a season of gratitude. I go, season of gratitude? He goes, yeah, look at all the blessings we have. And it was like a slap in the face. And I'm like,
wow,
boy, I needed that. I really needed that. So it's all about where your mind is, you know. Thankfully, and I'm blessed to have somebody that we are to each other. We do that. We put each other in the right perspective when we need it. So thank you. I love these five steps because I've been working on those. I haven't mastered them yet because I think it takes a while to master them. It's a really good five steps to have. I love them.
Well, thank you. And for me, I think it's important that everybody listening understands it's not about time. Because we could say that we're too busy. And I'm like, it's not, that thought at the end of the day is milliseconds. Your brain is so fast. Organizing your day when you get to where you said you already know what you have to do. It takes, what, a minute to write your list? I do it every morning. I know it takes about a minute, 2 minutes. Being mindful about how you return home. Now, what to do about it may take a little bit more time. Consume what you consume. Like, you can listen to me in the morning. You know, you can listen to somebody or do something, or maybe it's a push-up, maybe it's a prayer, whatever it is that's your thing. It's not always about a lot of time when you really add up what I shared. So I don't want people to be confused with it being time. It's about intent and consistency. Anything you do with intent and consistency, you will get better at, and your life will be better for it as long as it's in a positive direction.
Right. You're right. I will agree with you. Returning home, finding out how to change it is my whole problem. I know now, and I'm aware of it. It's what's going to take. What do I have to do, you know, to make myself switch it, to get that, you know, take the day, shrug it off, and not bring it in the house? You know,
sure.
What I've been trying to do is, give me 10 minutes. I need to go take 10 minutes.
Absolutely. And we can always revisit that feeling or conversation later. I'll share with my wife. Whatever she would have been frustrated with at 5 o'clock, we can still talk about it at 9 o'clock, but it's without the emotional content to it.
Right.
You know, it really is. So now it's about the issue and not always the feeling about it so much. And, now I'm a better listener. Because now I can put my feet up. I got a glass of wine. I got a cigar. You can chat all day at 9:30 at night. Like, so, you know, so it's not as intense with walking through the door at such a crucial time of day.
It's just hard to turn it off. If you only have a 15-minute drive, it's hard to turn it off. It's that quick.
And if you work from home, you don't even have an opportunity to turn it off because you're just – and I learned that doing a lot of work from home without travel. When I travel, I'm not here. However, when I'm not traveling, I'm always here. So – I know I might have to pick my son up from school and practice at, let's say, 5 o'clock, 5:30. If I decide to work straight up until 5:30 and then get in the car and go get him, I've given myself no reprieve, no transition time, no reflection time, no downtime. Therefore, I am intentional about maybe stopping at 5 o'clock, give myself that half hour before I go start my next role.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. I didn't want to miss the opportunity before we end today talking about the five types of leaders, because you talked about the motivator, but I did want you to talk to the audience about the five types, both the pros and cons of, of those leaders, if you don't mind.
Yeah, absolutely. So you do have the motivator. The pro is, remember, the passion. The concern is everybody may not react or respond to that style. So it's so important to know those seven languages, those seven professional languages, and have your one-on-ones. Then you have the example. They're the exact opposite. of the motivator. We tend to be a little bit more gregarious, more vocal. Our passion, we wear our feelings on our sleeve, good for better or for worse. The example, so quiet. All you would do if you were a fly on the wall is watch them do their job and get it done all day. That's it. The pro is the job gets done. The concern is they may lack the connection ability to connect with other employees. And a lot of employees don't want to interrupt the example because they're more stoic. They're so quiet and they don't want to interrupt them from their flow. And the example is willing to help, most likely. So it's so important for the example to set those one-on-ones to allow them to show their personality and to engage, because the example will put their head down and simply work. And if you work for an example, it's important to go and request those one-on-ones. Hey, I want to learn. I don't want to bother you during your day. You look super busy. Can I set up a time to talk to you? And most likely, they tend to say yes.
Is there a reason why they're so quiet and head down and focused?
They may be introverted by nature. They may be I do a lot of work with all different types of organizations. When you get into IT and engineering, you tend to get a lot of examples.
Okay.
You know, so head down, work more isolatory, more detailed and factual oriented. And it's not their proclivity to connect and engage and be social. Like, not every or all. Anytime you say that, you're wrong. However, it just tends to be that way, you know? Then you have the connector. So the connector, and you can be multiple types. Let me step back. Okay. A great leader is all five types, given who needs it and what the situation is that requires it from them. So a great leader is all five, given what's required. Okay. However, we all have a top one or two of who mm-hmm. we really are. And it can change over time. Okay? So, you have the connector type. They're friendly. They social butterflies. They know what you have for Thanksgiving dinner. They know that what sports your kids play. They know your husband or wife's name. Like, they are just social. People come to them with their professional and personal issues. Okay? They're connectors. The pro is everybody likes them. Mm-hmm. The concern is that they can get trapped in the friend zone very easily and lose their leadership. Because either they don't want to have the tough conversation, or the employee will trap them in the friend zone and won't let them have the tough conversation. Mm-hmm. Either way is a problem. So it's so important when you are the connector to make a preface statement. And I was a connector way back when, and I messed this up. So that's why I teach it. So I get to say, hey, Julianne, I know with the promotion or me being leader, this could be an odd dynamic because, you know, I don't want to lose the relationship that we have. So I'm going to be sure that we celebrate all your wins and we're going to have a great time doing it. As with anything, there might be some hiccups, and every now and then I might have to ask some questions or say something that's hard to hear, but I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't. Is that going to be okay? How do you want me to come to you if and when that's the case? Let them give you the blueprint. Let them give you the blueprint so when the time comes, because it will come. It might come in 6 days. It might come in 6 years, but daggone it, it's coming.
Right.
So now you get to go back and say, hey, Julianne, you got a second? And you remember that time where I said I might have to ask some questions and put the boss hat on for a look for a minute? Yeah. You ready? And then off we go. That will help the connector stay their personality, but also set some expectations that they're still a leader.
All right, that helps. It helps me because I'm a motivator and connector.
Yeah, it saves face, because people may still, they may treat you friendly, but they may treat you too friendly in the wrong setting. Mm-hmm. And then we get upset with them, but that's our fault that we didn't check it a while back.
Right.
Then you have the visionary. The visionary is the person, they stand on the mountaintop, they can see ideas. Usually people think they have crazy ideas, but they see bigger, they see farther. The pro is they are the people, like Blockbuster Video, wish they would have listened to their visionary.
Right.
The pro is they can see the future. They have ideas. The concern is they don't like the small steps of things. They tend to like the big idea, but don't want to do the work. Right. And there's a place for that. You're a leader. Your team is full of experts outside of what you're an expert at. So great, you have the idea. It's their job to pull off the impossible. Great. But we have to know, because I'm a visionary, you have to know enough. I hate the small details. Mm-hmm. But you have to know enough about them so you can properly reward your team for pulling off the impossible. You can't ask them to keep pulling off big tasks and then send them a thumbs up emoji when it's done. Mm-hmm. It's not acceptable. The last type is the intense. And it's just what it sounds like. And people think it's negative, and it's not. The intense is the person that tends to be very stoic, can't get a read. The intense is mostly described when they walk into a room, everybody scurries about to look busy, like, oh crap. They're very direct. They can be very blunt. And the pro is they spark movement. They're going to get results. The concern is the lack of connection. And it may be a company or a culture based off of fear.
Right.
Instead of genuine curiosity and a thriving environment. So I tell all of the intents out there, I said, look, you got three options. One, you can identify yourself as an equal opportunity intense person. I am this way with everyone. So please don't get offended. And when you do, if you do, come see me about it. We'll clean it up. Good? Great. You can say that. I don't recommend it, but you could.
Right.
Number two, you can speak the seven. Learn how to speak the seven. I teach it. Here's the seven languages your people need, want, and benefit most. They all have a top two. You have a top two. You have one that you don't like, but it might be their favorite one. So how do you speak it in casual times, whether it's in emails, making our email etiquette better? There's an intense leader out there, you would not believe this, that when they want coffee, they send their assistant an email with the capital letter C, and that's it.
That is so wrong.
Isn't it?
First of all, I get my own coffee. You don't. Oh, my God.
Isn't it? Now, needless to say, they go through about seven assistants a year, okay? So I wouldn't even categorize that as leadership. There's five types of leaders. There's five types of managers. That's abusive, okay? So, but if you're intense, you can say, I'm an equal opportunity. Most people can accept your consistency. They may not like it. It's like somebody saying hi to you on Monday, but not saying hi to you on Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
You can accept the always high. You can accept the always no high. But what you can't accept is the inconsistency.
Right.
So option number two, speak to seven. Know the seven. Be willing to speak it. You can have your one-on-one meeting. Speak it in there. Speak it in emails. Speak it in team meetings. Okay, so now you can be that way, but you're also being that way with their language.
Right. Wow.
Option number three, you can hire. Most can't do this, okay? Most don't have the bandwidth to do it. When you do, you can hire or promote a buffer.
Oh, boy.
So you are the intense,
right?
But you hire or promote a connector to be the buffer. So the people can come to the connector and the motivator type and like them. And then that person brings the information to make the decisions to the intents. Now, the intents may not fire or abuse the buffer. It's like Batman and Alfred. Batman never fires Alfred.
Wow. Yeah, I don't see many organizations having that bandwidth do that.
I've worked with one organization that did it.
Wow.
One. And it was because of that situation. So most
that's what I'm with won't. The C. The email with the C.
And it wasn't that one.
Wow. Well, you won't get an email with me with a C and a capital C. Interesting. Well, thank you. Well, on the flip, how about the five types of employees? Because that might help as a manager, that might help people understand the employees they're dealing with.
Oh, absolutely. So you have your inspired and motivated, number one. Everybody wants a plethora, a whole category of the inspired and motivated.
Yeah.
I see my battery. I'm about to have a faux pas so let me.
I've been there, done that.
Can you share a little bit about the book? and that will give me 30 seconds to get this. Guys, this is in real time. I am so sorry.
No, I love that we're in real time, but we're on in the book, The Leader's Toolbox. I'm going to show you this. And we're discussing the five types of employees. We just got done with the five types of leaders. And Andre does a great job explaining the different types of employees. So he's just going to go into each of those types so that we can kind of drill in to the employees that we have and how to work with each of those employees. And then I would love to have you all purchase both the Leader's Toolbox, Tools to Evolve Your Leadership, and then 7 Ways to Lead, Evolve Professionally and Personally. Both of those you can get out today. They're great books. I encourage you to read them. You're ready. Okay. You can go into the five types of employees.
So the inspired and motivated, like we talked about, everybody wants hundreds, if not thousands of them. And I tell organizations, be careful what you ask for.
Right.
The inspired and motivated got these big, wide saucer eyes. They're vacuuming in all of your information. Not only will they continuously say yes, we do a poor job of protecting them.
Mm-hmm.
Because they keep saying yes and they want to be great, we will keep asking them favors, duties, piling their desk. And because with hybrid and remote work, we may not actively see them burning out or boring out. They're not being challenged enough.
Right.
So they wind up burning out or boring out and leaving, or they burn out or bore out and stay.
Mm-hmm.
So it's so important that we understand why they're there. What's their dream? If it's related to our company and our vision, great. If it's not, great. How can you be curious about it and help? And at the very minimum, ask, hey, how's it going? So it's so important that we have them, we take care of them, we support them, and we do great. Make sure we have our expectations and we're holding everybody accountable, because they're going to meet it. But they're going to have a hard time continuously meeting when other people don't.
Right.
The second type, you have your steady stream. So you have your steady stream. These are people that are fine right where they are.
Mm-hmm.
And too many times as leaders, we give too much adulation, credit, and provide all of our resources into what? Our emerging leaders.
Mm-hmm.
They make up such a small portion of any company, but we'll overinvest in them. And that's great. Please do that. But you know who they count on? The steady streams. The people that are dependable. Right. Mm-hmm. They show up every day. They like their job. And we must understand as leaders, not everybody wants your 200 emails a day. Not everybody wants your raise. And if people are only accepting promotions to get job security and money, that doesn't mean you're getting a great leader. You might be losing your best machinist, and now you've promoted your worst leader.
Right.
So we have to be mindful. The steady streams, why are they there? What do they want to get out of being there? I've heard steady streams at organizations say, I want to be the best, for example, machinist here. I don't want a raise. I don't need a promotion. I just want the daggone machine to work.
Right.
You're trying to give this person a promotion. They just want you to fix the machine. Mm-hmm. Cost less.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Mm-hmm. You have your here, but not here. Okay. So the
those are the ones I don't want.
Now you got two different types. You got positive type, you got negative type.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you got the here but not here positive type, which is that they're here as a stepping stone. They're here to build their resume. I walked into a job as my last job as an employee. I said, listen, I'm Andre Young. I am a professional speaker. I am a writer. However, my business is doing part-time money good. My wife wants to build a new house, and I don't have build a new house money yet. So I need a job. Okay? I need a job. But I don't plan on being here for very long. But I'll be the best damn hire you've ever had, because I had 12 staff. How dare I not give you what I would want them to give me?
Right.
So I was the hear but not hear positive type. What you need? I'm not going to argue with you. You need me to do the dumbest thing in the world that I disagree with? Okay. And I'll do it to the best of my ability. And I'm leaving here at 5 o'clock. And then every now and then, my boss got to ask me, hey, how's your speaking? Bing, big smile across my face.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. And I didn't have to hide my real dream.
Right.
Now, the negative type, there's people out there that are actually trying to get fired. They're here, but they'd rather be anywhere else, and they're actively trying to get fired. And you get fired in this world that we live in with the litigious means it takes to get fired, you have earned it.
Right.
You have earned it. So please don't be afraid to have tough conversations and eventually follow your disciplinary practice. Leadership is not having the same tough conversation 17 times and not doing anything.
Right.
You have your new and unknown. They're new to your organization or team, and you don't know much about them. Therefore, it is so important to get them around your inspired and motivated as quickly as humanly possible. 19 years as a mental health therapist, and I'll tell you a few things that I learned. Number one, people want to do what they were initially trained to do. So you get them around the wrong type of employee that's taking shortcuts, negative gossiping, griping, and complaining. That's what they think is okay. And they tend to stick around who they initially got around. So get them around. In college football, in professional sports, they put the new recruit or the new free agent around the right players, the right people. And hopefully it rubs off.
Right.
Sometimes it doesn't, but hopefully it does. It's strategic.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then lastly is the grouch. The grouch is the complainer, the grump, and it's very important as a leader that one, we understand and have a little bit more curiosity about the grouch, because you didn't hire them that way. Hopefully they didn't sit in front of you all grouchy and you said yes.
Right.
Okay. So are they a grouch? Because just because they're a grouch and they're saying things you don't like doesn't mean they're wrong. Are they a grouch because of your poor leadership? Are they a grouch because of organizational dysfunction? Are they a grouch for things that you can control and have had a hand in? When it is, fix it. When it's not, you still have to set an expectation regardless, because this can't be the new way. But you got to make sure you're modeling it. And we got to be curious. Why is this person the grouch?
Mm-hmm.
I've had some people, they've experienced deaths in their family. Maybe at one woman, her son just overdosed, and then her boyfriend left her all within the 3-month period. You don't know what people are going through, and it's not your job to be their therapist. You can't fix every single thing. A little curiosity and a lot of empathy can go a long way, though.
Right.
And then you setting your what's your vision? Mm-hmm. What's your expectations? Mm-hmm. And what are your guidelines and rules that you're going to have for your team? And although you may be grouchy, I still need you following this. And when you can't, what can you do? And what can we do? Because we can't continue going in this fashion.
Mm-hmm. Right. Really talking to them is really important. And you even spoke about it in both when I've seen you in your presentations and in your book. You said to really talk to your employees about, what do you love being here? Why do you love being here? What do you love about being here? And then even asking, what can I do to find you? Those are really being vulnerable. That's a vulnerable question. And I think for leaders, it's hard to be vulnerable sometimes. But like you said earlier, if you're going to ask the question, you better be willing to hear that answer, right? And do something about it. I mean, not do something,
absolutely,
but at least hear it and make sure they know that you've heard them.
Right. And ask the people, okay, here's a hard leadership truth. Everybody that you lead, you're not going to like, and everybody that you lead is not going to like you.
Right.
If you're only asking the people that you like, that's not leadership. Go and ask your grouch. Just because they're a grouch doesn't mean they're wrong.
Right.
And you got to make some visits throughout your organization. The higher you move up, the more visits, every now and then you might have to visit some places in your organization that you're normally not seeing. I talk about a leader's visit, but asking these questions and getting some answers. And the thing you keep hearing the most is the common denominator.
Right. Start taking out to lunch. I start taking an employee out to lunch randomly. Just spend an hour with them and just say, this is your time with me. Tell me about how's it going, you know, personally and professionally. And then, you know, what can we do to help make your job easier? You know, and exactly what you're saying and really hearing them. Sometimes they're just shocked. It takes time for them to get comfortable with
it. Yes, right. Absolutely. Very much so.
Right. Well, this has been great. We could go on, I think, for another hour or two. I encourage our listeners, if they ever get a chance to hear you speak, to go and listen to you. You're phenomenal. I know you're going to be, you're going to be out in California, right?
Yes.
You're going to be out in Massachusetts. Any other one coming up soon that you're going to be at?
There's one in San Diego. Well, San Diego is the one for CSP, California Staffing Professionals. Looking at Portland for their Portland HR, they call it PERMA. That's just fun to say. Yeah.
We're hoping ASA, right? We're hoping you get to either ASA.
Yes. Just got an email about that a couple of days ago. It's been a positive whirlwind. And then there's Houston. So Houston HR, I'll be there in April as well. So there's a lot of good things coming up because people ask if they can hear me speak. And I'm like, typically speak at a lot of organizations. So for those individuals who have asked if they can hear me speak, the staffing associations and the SHRM conferences would really be a way to go.
Okay, great. And then you have a website where they can also engage in some of your tools, correct?
Oh, absolutely. youevolvingnow.com. So it's Y-O-U, evolvingnow.com. And there's, you know, the books there. There's free videos there. My services. And I'm very proud to say it took a lot of work. We updated my online bigger program, the Evolve and Lead training program. So perhaps you're an organization and that really allows you a cohort for C-suite and middle management, a cohort for more frontline who gets the least amount, if any, leadership training. And then you promote them and say, well, our people don't know how to lead. I'm like, well, why would they? They sold $1 million worth of product and they were offered the sales manager position. That doesn't mean they know how to lead.
No.
Then there's a leader's library with shorter leadership lunch and learns for ongoing. And a lot of companies enjoy that because it's not so time specific and intensive.
Great. Thank you. Yes. I encourage our listeners to really go out there and check out your website. You've got a great amount of tools out there for them, resources. So this concludes this month's podcast. I thank you so much, Andre, for your insight, for your information, for your friendship. You're a great guest to have. I look forward to seeing you soon at the next conference, and because you're always insightful, and I love your energy. Until next time, thank you very much.